Thank you, Tony. Thank you, everybody, for coming. I'm sure there are lots of other things you could have done tonight, but food isn't too bad, and the not Fujianese, however. And the company is fine, and hopefully we'll have a lot of things to share about the cooking from China's Fujian province. The book is kind of interesting because I am obviously not Fujianese. You need to look to see. And what's interesting is that most Americans haven't a clue about Fujianese food, and that's because there are only two things written bilingually. One is by a woman from Hong Kong who's written a lot of cookbooks, and her husband is Fujianese. And there are two sentences in the book about the cuisine, though there are 50 Fujianese recipes. The other book is by a chef who has cooked in a Fujianese restaurant. And there are two pages of preliminary information, a page and a half about the chef and a half a page about the cuisine. In this book, I tried to provide a lot of information about the cuisine, the culture, and information about each recipe in it. In case you don't know where Fujian is, you do have a sheet of paper which has a picture of the cover of the book, so you know what we're talking about. Also has my business card in the top right-hand corner. And under the picture of the book, there is a map, so you can look at where Fujian is. There's a T just to the left of an arrow, the T standing for Taiwan. It is right across the Straits of Taiwan is where that province is. Don't want those things to break. You all know that China's food is both complex and varied, and you all know that it's got more than one cuisine, though I wish that some of the people who write about Chinese food would figure that out. One could look at the cuisine and examine it dynasty by dynasty. That's great for a historian. I'm not really a trained historian. But most folks really prefer to look at it the way I do, the foods of China region by region. And Fujian is such a region. I assume that all of you know that the Chinese food provides daily sustenance to a quarter of the world's population. Almost another quarter is Asian Indian. That means half of the people are from those two countries eating that food of the world. And if you understand foods from Asia, it really opens a window on both of them and also on the rest of the countries in Asia and the Asian people who live all over the world. You might not think about it, but it makes sense. Quickly, you will realize that at any given meal, more people in the entire world are eating Chinese food than any other food from any other culture in the world. Yet, amazingly, the world seems to know very little about Chinese food, particularly if you're not Chinese. For a myriad of reasons, I wish I knew. Chinese food, though exceptionally important from my prejudiced point of view, and perhaps some of yours, is not at all well known by the food reporters. So I hope that all of you will go out there and say something to somebody that those people should really be paying more attention to it, when more than half of the world is eating foods from Asia and they're just not paying attention to foods from that part of the world. But to understand the foods of China, about 1.5 billion people, means to learn about foods from many regions in China, not just from Fujian. And they're as different as the dialects and as the people. It's a huge country, China's size, about the same physical size as the United States, but many, many more people, certainly than in the United States. And people have estimated, on the conservative side, that there are 10,000 plus different Chinese recipes. So how can anyone know anything about all of them? It's a good question. I don't know. I've studied it for getting close to 40 years now, and I certainly don't know. And most of the Western world hasn't figured it out either. The question is, how do you describe Chinese foods? Can any of you describe to me American foods? Tell me, what's an American food?
Steak.
Steak. Okay, there you go. Certainly all American foods are not alike, and all Chinese foods are not alike, depending on where the people in China come from. Knowledgeable folks say that there are eight different and outstanding Chinese culinary styles. Anybody here want to venture a guess as to what they are? That's a silent audience. How about that? If you look at your map on this piece of paper, you'll notice that there are eight regions, that is by colored, eight different colors. The question is, are those the eight styles? The quick answer is no. But how many can you name now looking at a map? The chances are very few. Let me give you a hint. They're all provinces, and this map is showing the provinces. I don't want you to feel bad that you don't know, so I'm going to tell you what they are, and I'm going to tell it in alphabetic order. Anhui, Fujian, Guangdong, Hunan, Jiangsu, Shandong, Sichuan, and Zhejiang. Anybody writing this down want a repeat of the eight? No, okay. Clearly you can't guess correctly what they are, and certainly people don't know what the foods are in any one of them. Most people do it the simplistic way. You know, there are four cuisines in China, and they look at the compass points, you know, north and south, east and west. But really, there's a lot more than that. Not only are there a lot more, but there are people who would say, hey, Jackie, eight? Uh-uh. That's too simplistic. China's a country with more than 60 political divisions. Actually, 62 to be exact. What are they? Well, looking at the map, you can say right away you got the 22 provinces there. You also have five autonomous regions, 31 autonomous prefectures, four major municipalities. Do you think that each of these has a distinctive cuisine? Well, if you're a Chinese culinary historian, you would instantly answer, you bet. But many culinary aficionados, even in China, will say no. But they do give credence to 27 different culinary influences. I gave you eight before. Since you couldn't guess them, I won't even ask if you can deal with the 27. But let me tell you what they are, again, in alphabetic order. Anhui, Beijing, that's a city, of course, Fujian, Gansu, Guangdong, Guangxi, Guizhou, Henan, Hainan, Hong Kong, Hebei, Hunan, Inner Mongolia, Jiangsu, Jiangxi, Liaoning, Qinghai, Shanxi, Shandong, Shanghai, Shanxi, Sichuan, Taiwan, which we can have an argument as to where, you know, which country that belongs to, Xinjiang, Zhejiang, which we know is Tibet, Yunnan, and Zhejiang. The Chinese food historians will separate cuisine into those differences. Some of them, of course, are better known than others, some of them from larger populations than others, and most of them not known outside of China. Even their names are not known. But yet they're very important, and you're here to learn about one of them, the foods of the Fujian province. We used to say and spell, in the United States at least, Fujian differently. We now spell it as F-U-J-I-A-N. And the foods of this province come from the ancient Min culture. It's reputed to be more than 2,000 years old. And it's a culture that mixed with the Han, Chinese, and we knew them over the years by different names, as Min Yue, Bai Yue, probably became well known in China, certainly, since the Warring States period, and that was from 475 to 221 BCE. There's also a comparable culture talked about in Taiwan called Holo. These people were first mentioned in the Book of Rites, which the Chinese refer to as the Zhou Li, and they talked about them as seven tribes. And it's interesting because some of the literature says, there's eight tribes. So there seems to be a point of discussion there, if you will, as to what were the groups that were formed that became the Fujianese culture. This is very early in Chinese history, in the Zhou dynasty. These are all pre-Qin dynasties. And some people say they have roots all the way back to 1000 BC. Not much is written about it. What is written afterwards about what happened before. That said, these ancient Min cultures are very different, yet very commonplace in terms of Chinese food and food habits. But old or new, the Fujianese cuisine has no cookbook, as I told you before, before mine, about the food culture. Many people have asked, well, why did you write it? Well, it has to do with a little bit of a bet. There is a gentleman who is a major officer in a Fortune 500 company. It's a Chinese company. And he once said to me, hey, you know, Jackie, there's more than 100,000 Fujianese people living south of Canal Street. And I said, Donald, you're nuts. Not possible. And he said, yes. I don't want to do any, you know, quoting of numbers without some factual information. So he had his drivers, who deliver noodles and fortune cookies and things of that nature, to restaurants, start querying the Fujianese restaurant owners as to where they live. And when he had some very high numbers, not 100,000, but about half of that, living south of Canal Street, I said, okay, I give up, you win. He said, okay, if I win, you lose, what are you going to do? Why don't you write a book about Fujianese food? And that was probably the first seed in my brain, if you will, to do that. Those two other books I mentioned are listed in a collection of Chinese cookbooks at Stony Brook University, which I donated, more than 3,000 in the English language, and lots of others. And if you want some information about those cookbooks, or any Chinese cookbooks for that matter, I recommend that you go to Stony Brook's website. I'll give the website information in a couple minutes. What's unique about my book, other than I think it's great, and I do, prejudiced though I may be, is that there's probably a dozen pages of information about the general culture in Fujian. There's also some cultural information about every single recipe, one by one. And I often say my claim to fame with reference to this book is that five major culinary authorities said it's a great book. And bless them all. Sidney Mintz, probably the most famous anthropologist in the United States. Grace Young, who wrote Breath of a Wok, and you probably know her for other things as well. Ian Anderson, who has written Food Culture of China, and never a cookbook himself, as a matter of fact. And two famous Chinese chefs, Martin Yan and Ken Ham, and I don't think they need introduction. All of these people were very pleased to see it done, and I kept teasing them, well, why didn't you do it? You know, you probably know more than, certainly knew more than when I began. And they said, no, you did a fine job. And simply tell people about that. Tell them about your cookbook collection, the other two large Chinese cookbook collections in the United States. One is at the Shields Library at Davis, and one is the Library of Congress in Washington, D.C. The Shields Library has about 1,000 Chinese cookbooks. The Library of Congress has close to 700 Chinese cookbooks. And Stony Brook University has more than 3,000 Chinese cookbooks. So if any of you are ever interested in doing some research on Chinese food, that's certainly one of the places to go. I would also provide the website address for those of you who are not as familiar as I'm beginning to become, if you will. And that is, it's www.stonybrook.edu, Stony Brook is one word, and then a / Live special, because it's in the special collections area, /collection/rare books. If that's too complicated and you didn't write it down, just Google my name. And it will come up, and you don't even have to know all of that. But anyhow, enough of that. Let's get back to Fujianese food, which certainly is hardly known outside of China, hardly known in the United States. Though there are almost 400,000 Fujianese now living in the United States, not all in New York for sure. More than any other country in the world, other than China, of course. And they have been for years in lots of other countries because the Fujianese are phenomenal seamen. They have from thousands of years gone out to find more food. It's a country that has occasional droughts, two or three a year, that occasional. And they really needed to go out and find more food. They liked what they found. Some of them came back and brought the notions back with them. Some of them stayed in other countries. And it has been guesstimated that there's probably a handful or more Fujianese people in every country in the world. That's more than, you know, any other culture. It's, to me, it blows my mind. I'd like to say one other thing about these immigrants, in that many of them came to this country long before we were wise enough to call them Fujianese. And they were very mixed with the Toshanese people who first came here, and Cantonese people. So they've been in the United States a lot longer than credit has been given to them with reference to that. When the first one came, beats me. I haven't found anything in all my meanderings on web of when the first Fujianese came to the United States. The guess is in the late 1800s. But that's the notion that most of these people from the province of Fujian emigrated very directly to our big cities, and most of them came from two big cities in that province, from Fuzhou and Xiamen. Fujian is one of the provinces listed in that 8 that I gave you, and listed also in the 27. It's a major regional cuisine with roots in a very ancient culture, and a culture that had wings that spread out all over, first to the neighboring islands near there. And the province of Fujian has more than 100 islands right on the seacoast off. And also, they emigrated to Taiwan, correctly called the Republic of China. And it has a very distinctive cuisine, and it's very complex cuisine, and yet it's very simple to make. Because the one thing that the Fujianese people adore is soup. I don't care if you make it with a lot of water and it's like a broth, or you make it with a little bit of water or another liquid and it's like a casserole. But they wouldn't dream of a meal with less than two soups or casseroles. Most of them have more. And certainly if you ever went to a Fujianese banquet, if they served you less than five, some people would say it's a crummy banquet. Because the more soups at a meal, the better they like them. So you see on the map where Fujian is. It's south of Shanghai. And it's on the mainland, right across the Taiwan Straits from Taiwan. And it's very interesting because the people in Taiwan will tell you that their cuisine is very close to Fujianese cuisine. And the people in Fujian will tell you that their cuisine is very close to Taiwanese cuisine, but never the twain shall touch. It is amazing how different. One of the foods, and I'm going to pass it around, that the Fujianese adore, that's in almost all of their dishes, is a leftover, if you will, from when you make wine. It's called red wine lees, and make sure you sniff it in, because exactly what it sniffs like is what it tastes like. It's a solid. It's made from wine that's made from red glutinous rice. And this is the dregs, or the leftovers, or in English we call it the lees, L-E-E-S, of the wine. And this is in many, many dishes. And it turns them red. It is not colored. The good stuff is not colored. It has a distinctive aroma. You may or may not like the aroma and or the taste. I'm married to a gentleman who didn't care for the taste, and so when I was testing the recipes, he was much happier if I tested them in someone else's house or at lunchtime while he was at work. There is a white glutinous rice. And if I do that, I'm going to have a puddle here on the floor. This is much more liquid. This one is actually more Shanghai style than Fujian style. But both of them made from glutinous rice, and you really want to smell them, and we'll put them out on the table later and you can taste them if you wish. The white one has almost no aroma, except the smells of wine. The red one has a very distinctive aroma. The dishes are turned red when it's used in any quantity. And most Fujianese restaurants will have a dish that says something or other Fujian style. And you can bet your bottom dollar that the red glutinous rice is in that dish. One of the more popular dishes is something called pork with lychee flavor. There's no lychees in there. The sauce tastes very much like the liquid in a can of lychees, if you will. But the pork looks bright red because it's coated with flour and some of that red glutinous rice paste that's going around. Fuzhou is the capital of this province, and their style foods are one of the three kinds of foods in this rather small province. Foods of that style include foods from cities such as Mintung, Mingcheng, and Minbai. They're lightly seasoned, not very salty, and less sweet than most other Chinese foods in that province or anywhere else in China for that matter. As I said before, it's a cookery that emphasizes soups and casseroles at every meal, breakfast, lunch, and dinner. The soups are delicious. They do have very elegant flavors. They're very fresh. They're made with very fresh ingredients, lots of seafood. They're grease-free, and many of them do have sweet and sour tastes if they're from the region around the capital city of Fuzhou. And they will include red or white wine leaves, equivalent to the stuff that's going around. In Fujian, they adore the red wine lees 10 times more, if you will, than the white or the wine lees made from white glutinous rice. But they really like both of them. And they really are so popular, they like them in dumplings and fish balls and seafood dishes, lots of other dishes, noodle dishes. I told you about the pork with lychee, which is one of their famous dishes, and lots of soups and casseroles. That's one region of Fujian around the capital, and the capital is marked on your map, if you will. A second cuisine within the province of Fujian is called Minnan style. Here the foods are from Xiamen, the second largest city in the province, Quanzhou, not Quangzhou, no G, Quanzhou, Jiangzhou, and also some of the foods that moved across the Taiwan Straits to Taiwan are most popular in this region. Here the dishes are very aromatic. If you walk in and you smell a dish and it doesn't smell from the red wine lees, it's a good chance that it's the Minnan style, southern style of Fujian cooking. They're light, they're a tiny bit sweet, and some of them have a little bit of chili, but not spicy like in the Sichuan province, just a touch of chili, if you will. Some people call this, you want to put them back on the table with the food and then people can look at them later? Thank you so much. In this southern region, they don't use as much of the fermented wine lees as in and around Fuzhou. The third region in Fujian is the western region, or the Minxi region, and it's very salty and much more piquant. Some people mistake it for Sichuan food cooked for people who don't like hot foods. It's also thicker and it's heavier than the other two Fujianese regional styles. It's also more related to Hakka foods. There are a large number of Hakka people, the wandering originally from western part of China that came down and settled in and around Guangzhou. Also, because of the nature of the physical nature of the land, there's lots of herbals in this particular western batch of Fujianese food. What's interesting about Fujian, if you look at the map, you can't tell because it's not topographical, but the province is really surrounded on three sides by mountains. So there are plenty of mountains for people to go and pick herbs, and they do. And in this western part of China, As typical of Hakka foods, in winter the foods have stronger tastes, and in the summer they have lighter tastes. So that sometimes you can't tell if you don't stop and think, whoops, which season are we in? And then pay attention. So those are the three culinary branches, if you will, of the Fujianese cuisine. Fuzhou, Minnan, and Minxi. But there are other differences that people from Fujian recognize that you or I might not. And most of these other differences, one can argue, because some people will call them commonalities. Because how the foods are cut is critical in the Fujian province. All Chinese people are concerned about how food is cut. And if you change the shape of the food and cut across the grain or with the grain, you'll change the texture. In Fujian, they're nuts. They're nuts in that they want specific dishes with foods cut specific ways. I must confess that I didn't put that in the book because the publishers were a little bit uptight about, hey, if you make this so complicated, nobody's ever going to want to do it. But there are very many differences. But there's a commonality that's very important, and that's probably only in the Fujian province. And that is that most dishes have meat and foods of the sea together. On your handout, if you will, right under the picture of the next issue of the Flavor and Fortune magazine, which I edit, is a picture of fish balls. Now that white looks like dough. It is chopped up, or in cheap restaurants, ground up fish with a tiny, tiny bit of starch in it. And inside the fish ball is a meatball. That's very typical of Fujianese cuisine. Another thing that's very typical of Fujianese cuisine, I mentioned about the cutting. If you look at the picture under the map, that's jellyfish. And if you notice very carefully, there are three different ways that are shown of the jellyfish cut in that dish. There's only one of the province that concerns themselves with that kind of differential of cutting in jellyfish and other seafood dishes, and that's not a province, but rather three provinces, the three northeastern provinces of Dongbei. Heilongjiang, the most northern, Jilan in the middle, and Liaoning, the southernmost of those three provinces. But the Fujianese do this as well. While we have this picture in hand, let me point out two typical things. They make a scallion pancake that looks like every other scallion pancake, the one on the bottom right. But if you look above that, there are four different buns, and they translate them with a word that we say is buns, or they also call them breads. And what these flat things are filled with different kinds of filling, and all Fujianese people can look at this and say, whoops, see that top one there on the right? Nothing in that one. You see that one catty corner to that with that one little black circle of black sesame seeds? Well, they know that that's got a bean sauce in that one. They also make a different one with two of these little black circles and one with four of these black circles and of sesame seeds. And if you were from Fujian, you would know specifically what that filling is. Should you want to taste them, there is a place here on West 3rd Street, right near 6th Avenue, that sells these. As a matter of fact, they were photographed in their other place in Flushing. But that makes them, and they're really very good. And sometimes they're in a super generous mood, and they have a little, they won't do this season, but in warmer weather, they'll have a little table outside, and they'll cut them in quarters, and you can go by and taste them for nothing, if you will. But these are typical Fujianese dishes. And some of them, like the scallion pancake, looks like other scallion pancakes. However, the greens in it will be scallions and herbs, whereas in the rest of China, the greens would just be scallions in the scallion pancake. So these kinds of differences are very unique to a cuisine that people who really know the cuisine can speak to, if you will. Actually, I didn't mention, and I should, that the meat inside those fish balls is pork. And I've never had it with anything other than minced pork. And the Fujianese would not grind the pork again, like they would not grind the fish, but rather they would mince it by hand. And when you bite in, you think it's an ordinary fish ball. And it can be in a soup, it can be in a casserole, it can be just in a fried dish with some there. But when you taste it, you know right away. Throughout Fujian, because the fourth side, the three sides of mountains, the fourth side is the seacoast, they probably collect more than 200 kinds of fish, shellfish, turtles, and frogs. And also, if you go to a Chinese restaurant and you see a frog casserole, the odds are 10 to 1, it's Fujianese. Maybe the whole restaurant is not Fujianese, but certainly that particular dish is Fujianese. And they cook in a myriad of ways. When we think of Cantonese food, most people think of stir fry. Stir fry is a rather new technique to the Chinese. It's certainly not more than 200-300 years old. The Fujianese do a little bit of stir frying, but mostly they stew or they braise, or they quick or long cook things, they steam cook things, and they really delight in having many different kinds of cooking in different dishes at the same meal. You would not get, you know, if it's a meal and there are five people, they have five stir-fried dishes, never. You would get five different dishes, only one of which would be stir-fried, the others would be other culinary techniques. They like different flavors and different cooking techniques at every meal. There's a classic dish in the Fujian cuisine, and it's the bottom here. You can see it's a wine dish. It's a stewed wine dish, and that's a dish called Buddha Jumps Over the Wall. The story that comes with it was that any monk in his right mind who would smell this outside the wall of the monastery would be convinced that he's got to jump over and go get himself some. The Fujianese call it Foti Sokyang, and though there's no proof that any Buddhist monk ever went over the wall, if you will, for a taste, the aroma is so tantalizing, and that particular picture was taken in Taipei in a Fujianese restaurant with Angela Cheng, who is the daughter of Fu Pei Mei, who took me to that restaurant, and the dish was just spectacular. And if I had to describe to you how they make it, and it looks like a small wine pot, but it's about this big. What's interesting in my mind, a Westerner's mind now, no Chinese would say this, but in a Westerner's mind, it's made lasagna style. By that I mean it's made in layers, and the bottom layer is the fish or meat that cooks the longest. And as it's continuing to cook, and the wine pot is put in water, and it's steamed, they keep adding different layers until, you know, they get to near the top, if you will. And this particular dish then cooks for about an hour more than when the last item went in, and then it is served. Now, there are many, many recipes for it, and actually the book has two or three. But it's a very interesting dish, and any time you see it, even if it's just in any old casserole, not in a wine pot casserole, and you start to eat from that dish, and you notice that it's in layers, and that it's got meat and fish, because almost all Fujianese dishes have both, you really know right away, I'm eating a Fujianese dish, if you will. There are lots of other famous dishes, but what kinds of fish and what kinds of meat do they put in this one? Because those same fish and meat appear in lots of other dishes, not necessarily in layers and not always together. But it has shark's fin, almost always. It has abalone, fresh and dry scallops. They like a lot of fresh and dry fish, seafoods together, if you will. It'll have ham and chicken, Mushrooms, listen, they've got all those mountains. They're up there, you know, collecting mushrooms all the time. Yams and a berry that we used to call medlar or wolfberry, which has just recently, probably 6 months ago, been renamed the goji berry, G-O-J-I. You know, it's like the kiwi. You know, you couldn't sell the Chinese gooseberry for a nickel anywhere around the world. And then some bright PR guy said, hey, let's rename it the kiwi. And, you know, New Zealand started to sell them by the ton. So it is with the wolfberry medlar, which we now call the goji berry. You couldn't sell them. I mean, Chinese herbal stores carried them, but they just were hardly available anywhere. And now every Western market is selling them and talking about this new delicious berry. Turns out very one of the highest in vitamin C of any berry. I mean, it's bright red and it's little. It's probably the size of your pinky nail. And the better ones are a little bit longer, a little bit thinner, and a little bit softer. Softer because they haven't been dried for that long. Good cooks make lots of great Fujianese foods. And the more complex the dish is in your mind or by looking at the list of ingredients, the Fujianese have figured out a way to do this in a simplistic fashion. The fish balls, I didn't give you the Chinese name before, but yu huan is the Chinese name for the fish balls that have meat inside. They're also made so simplistically. The only thing you have to know when you want to make them, other than chop up the ingredients and maybe put a few herbs and seasoning in either the meat or the fish, more in the meat than in the fish, is to wet your hands. If you wet your hands, it's nothing. You know, play roly-poly, and they're easy to make. If you don't wet your hands, I don't know why I ever made this recipe in the first place, you know, because I'm a mess, and it's all over me, and whatever. There's another well-known Fujianese dish you should know about, banh mian bian rao, and I thought I was bringing the Fujianese noodles, and I didn't. But this is a typical Chinese flat noodle, not Fujianese. And the Fujianese noodles are so thin, they're like the hairs on your head, and you could probably fit anywhere between 25 and 50 into the space of this particular noodle. They're just amazingly thin, and it makes all the difference in the world when you taste the dish when the ingredient is cut, or in this case, pulled. The right way, and good Fujianese noodles are pulled. Of course, the ones you buy in the store are made by machine. They're mechanically put together, if you will, pulled, but pulled by machine. And if you want to find some, go on East Broadway. There are many Fujianese restaurants on East Broadway, and there are also many Fujianese vendors. They're on the corner right near the Manhattan Bridge, where the Manhattan Bridge goes over. And those corners right there, and they're just wonderful, but when you carry them home, be careful, because you can make them disintegrate, disappear. They are so thin, so fine, so brittle, that they just fall apart, literally, almost, you know, as soon as you touch them. And that noodle dish is also made with meat and fish in the same dish, because that's just typical of what's in there. Lots of people say to me, well, Jackie, I know about this particular Fujianese recipe. What are the ingredients? My answer always is chef's choice. Because there are no real what has to be in a particular dish. It just has to be lots of them, lots of different ingredients, preferably made like a soup or a stew, and preferably different soups and stews at the same meal. Great cuisines really need great food resources, and Fujian has them. It has all those mountains on the three sides. The soil in the center part, the plateau part, if you will, is unbelievably rich from, it's a rainy climate. So from all the leaching from the highlands, if you will, into the lowlands, and this extensive coastline, and hundreds and hundreds of little islands, most inhabited. Fishing clearly is a major industry and has been for generations. And the Fujianese people, more than any other Chinese group of people are unbelievably open-minded about new tastes and new foods. And so these fishermen went out, caught varied and sundry things, also stopped at islands, Fujianese, but also other islands, you know, near Malaysia, Singapore, wherever. And they brought foods back. And these foods got incorporated into the cuisine. And they got incorporated years and years ago. You talk about Taiwanese food, and you have to say, hey, there's a big Japanese influence. Yeah, there is. But it came in 75 years when Japan was, you know, in charge of Taiwan. You talk about the Northeast, and you say, oh, wow, that, you know, those three provinces are between Russia here and Korea over here. You got some Russian potato, whatever, foods, and you have lots of kimchi and spicy and Korean food. Sure, but that influence is a very short time frame. The influence of foreign foods on the Fujianese cuisine is probably 1,000 years or more. Because the people were going out in their boats and collecting things. Some of them stayed, some of them brought other foods back. And the cuisine is just loaded with every fruit, vegetable, meat, fish, grain you can think of. So it's a very complex cuisine. And it's interesting because they made all of the dishes traditionally Fujianese. Didn't matter what they brought back. They made it look like, taste like Fujianese food. So this cuisine really has a very important place in the Chinese culinary history, if you will. Some people say, okay, well, what are you talking about? How big is this country anyhow, lady? Well, I told you something about how diverse the topography was, but the size of the country is about the size of England. It's not a very large province. I keep referring to it as a country. I've worked so long on the book that I really see it as a country and not a province in my own mind, but that's, of course, incorrect. It is a province. And it's about 45,000 square miles. It's not a very large province at all. And the eastern edge, the seacoast edge, is unbelievably ragged. Some people have tried, Googling the coastline to see what they could determine is the actual number of miles of coastline. But because it's so ragged and it's going so in and out, and discounting the islands nearby, they guess that it's about 2,000 miles of coastline. That's a lot of coastline where people were, you know, pushing their ships out into the sea, if you will. It's a monsoon-type climate, and it's pretty warm in general. It's frost-free probably for 250 to 300 days a year. And when they have a frost, it's for a day or two, not very much. They have very demarcated rainy seasons, three of them. They have lots of water for the crops. But they also have lots of floods, lots of droughts, lots of windstorms, and lots of natural disasters. So these people said, hey, I want out. And so they pushed off in their boats, and they went off to other islands and other countries. And, you know, it's a subtropical place with a lot of negatives as well as some positives. And many of them didn't come back. And, of course, now they go, you know, not just by these little boats. They push off from shore, but by the bigger ships and of course, by air. And most of them that have come to this country, can't come by ship, have come by air. And it's amazing. It's also amazing that they gave their cuisine to Taiwan. But Taiwan, at the nearest, is 4 miles away. At the furthest, it's about 60-odd miles away. Got very little in food culture back from Taiwan. Even the Japanese influence has not really come to Fujian, if you will. Some of the people in the Fujian province are of the She nationality, so they have different customs and foods. Some are Mongolian from the Yuan dynasty, which was 1279 CE. I mean, you know, that's a while back. Some are Manchurian, or we would now call them Dongbei. We don't use the term Manchu anymore. And that came into the Fujianese culture about 1644 and up until, 1911, if you will. So there are all of these kinds, and there are lots of other population groups that came from a little bit further north, from Shanghai, you know, all the way and Guangzhou, below, that landed in that area, and some of the people liked it and they stayed. So you got all these great resources, you got all this external influence, if you will, and you have another thing in Fujian, which you could say also about the Cantonese people, the people from Guangzhou, and that is that they have a huge respect for education and a huge respect for knowledge about foods. And these things were really put together, and there's a lot in Chinese about their food, not very much in English, but a lot in Chinese about how the foods developed over the centuries. And in a library in Beijing, I once asked, I was taken in at a time when Westerners were not supposed to go into the library, but I once asked, can I see, you know, where your provincial books are? This was before I had any notion that I was going to write a Fujianese cookbook, or any cookbook for that matter. And it was amazing the number of running feet of cookery material from a single province and from all of the provinces. And if you go to a Chinese bookstore, and there are two main ones in Beijing and two main ones in Shanghai, the Xinhua bookstores, and the number of cookbooks available from different provinces is mind-blowing. There's even one from Dangbei, one from three provinces. There's one in Chinese. It's not a particularly important cuisine to the Chinese, whereas Fujianese cuisine is very important to the Chinese. And I was in a bookstore in Shanghai in this past December, and they must have had in Chinese, and obviously I can't read them, they must have had 200 books about Fujian. And the people who were taking me around said, well, you want us to buy you any? Most of them had no pictures or poor pictures. And I said, thank you, but no thank you. It was amazing, however, the number of books they had. And there now is a Xinhua bookstore in Flushing on Main Street, if you want to meander there. So now you know a lot about the generic information. Let me tell you about just a few of the foods that the Fujianese people like. They love olives, they love oranges, they love longans, and they love lychees, and they eat lots of them. And they even imitate those flavors, like I told you about the pork with lychee, and no lychees in it, but they imitate it. They love mushrooms, they love meat pastes, so they can put it inside things. They love medicated wines and all kinds of herbal things. And also one of the provinces that probably eats the most dried marine foods of any of the provinces in China. They adore bananas, the glazed fruits, vinegars, and they have more teas in the Fujian province almost than in the Yunnan province. Most of them are oolong teas. They have a few pu'er teas, but they really just love different teas, and they also cook with tea. They cook both with the leaves as a vegetable, and the leaves dry, and also with the brewed tea. One of the interesting things about Fujian is, I mentioned before they had lots of famines. Well, there was one year in the 1500s when the famines were dreadful. And the ruler decided, hey, I heard that in this country, in Chinese, we would say in English, the Philippines, they have a tuber that is really great, grows no matter what, wet, dry, and really can stave off starvation. So he sent some ships to the Philippines, and they brought back lots of sweet potatoes with eyes on them so that they could plant them. And within a few months, they had a good-sized sweet potato crop. And probably the only province in China where the people like and eat lots of sweet potatoes is the Fujian province. Most other people think, ah, that's food for the poor. I don't want that stuff. But it's a staple along with wheat and rice in Fujian. People like in most of the rest of China eat three meals a day and lots of snacks. And if you go to a Fujianese restaurant, make sure that you order a couple of soups, or they'll say, these folks don't know anything. And if they kind of like you and they really want to help you along, they'll just put an extra soup or two on your plate, because to them it's not a meal unless you have a few of them. They'll put a little bit of sugar in all their savory dishes, a little. They'll put a lot of coriander and a little bit of sesame oil in a lot of their dishes, and they'll garnish them even if it's not a banquet. In most Chinese meals, there's very little garnish. I mean, some of the westernized restaurants, you know, put an orchid on the plate, you know. The Chinese, you know, think that's kind of silly, waste the flour that way. But it's interesting because in Fujian restaurants, they'll garnish the foods, and it's not a banquet. They also, I mentioned before, and I can't emphasize enough, put this red wine lees and white wine lees in everything that they cook. And it's amazing how well they use everything that they have, because about 35% of their land is forest, it's mountainous. So they can't grow stuff. So, okay, got some herbal stuff and some mushrooms there. And obviously they have minerals. They're huge producers of copper and tungsten, for any mineralogist here. And they export huge amount of their foods, the manufactured. They also have more arable land than any other province in China. Almost twice as much. Not quite, but almost twice as much. And they have, I guess I'd say, a give a damn. They really care a lot about the foods that they're raising and the foods that they're cooking and the history of the foods. And they really work very, very hard to see to it that they put across this caring, if you will, to the rest of us. Nowadays, not only are they growing everything, cultivating mushrooms, they're also farming all of the sea creatures. So that you never know if what you're eating is, you know, wild or farmed. And there is a difference in taste for the people who have very sensitive set of taste buds. They also have huge tea plantations. And they like their tea fully fermented, what we Westerners would call black, or the Chinese would call red tea. They are not gung-ho for very green teas. They do consume a reasonable amount of oolong tea, but mostly they like black teas, and they adore pu'er tea. And for those of you that don't know, pu'er is the only black tea that's oxidized twice. The literature says fermented twice, but it's really not fermented. It's really oxidized twice. And it's also the only tea that's aged in China. And you can buy a 5-year-old, a 10-year-old, a 25-year-old pu'er tea. And it's also the only tea where you can make multiple pots, not two or three, but 20, 25 pots with the same batch of tea leaves from pu'er tea. So how can I end? Well, I can end by saying that I think it's an extremely creative cuisine. It's a cuisine you ought to try. You ought to try it in restaurants. You ought to try it by cooking some recipes. Obviously, I say you should cook them from my book. Why not? The glossary in the book has lots of lists of ingredients, and most people don't know what a lot of these ingredients are. I tried to be very clear there. And I think you should go home and try some Fujianese food. Let me tell you of a couple of Fujianese restaurants in Manhattan and Queens. You almost could go down East Broadway and find anything in East Broadway. There's a new one called Xian Shang on 1 East Broadway, easy address to remember, that has very good Fujianese food. Its menu, if they have menus in a little plastic container outside, and the menu says Fuzhou, but the blue sign above it says Xiangsha Shun. And that's pretty good Fujianese restaurant. There are lots of other smaller ones on East Broadway, particularly on the north side of the street. Some of them called Fuzhou, Fujian, and other less creative names, you know, like the major cities in Fuzhou. In Flushing, I feel blessed. I taught at Queens College for lots of years, in that the restaurants are much more sophisticated in terms of different regional cuisines. And if you go on 40th Road, as an example, there are 2 Fujianese restaurants that are great. One is called ADA Fujian. I can't get anybody there to tell me what the ADA stands for. And the other one is called Fortune Fuzhou. There is a third one that opened some weeks and closed others, simply called Fujian. I don't know why. But most Fujianese restaurants, well, all Chinese restaurants pretty much have their menu pasted on the glass outside. And just look and see if you see a pork with lychee or a pork with lychee sauce. See if you see a fish balls. And see if you see some rabbit or frog in Fuzhou sauce. And that is a Fujianese restaurant. And I would certainly avail myself of going in and trying and talking to the staff. Some of them are reasonably good with the English language, most of them not. So if you go with someone who's Chinese, or if you are Chinese, you don't have the problem. And be willing to taste. I bet you you'll have a great meal. It will be different than other Chinese food, you know, I promise that. But it will be very, very good. So do emulate the taste. Try out the restaurants. There are some Chinese cookbooks with a few Fujianese recipes. Perhaps you have some of those at home. The library certainly has them. And I would encourage you to give serious thought, particularly if you get very serious about the cuisine of this culture, of purchasing this book, convincing your library to buy it, whatever, so that you have an opportunity to try many of the recipes. Let me end, first of all, by thanking you for coming, thanking you for your attention, if you will. And ask if you have any questions about Fujianese cuisine or other cuisines, which perhaps I can answer. I do edit and have for the past 15, going on 16th year, this Chinese food magazine, the only English language Chinese food magazine in the United States, and I'll be glad to tackle some questions.
What kind of wines do they have, and are they sort of taken at particular occasions?
Well, they cook with their wine. They do a lot of cooking with the wine. The top part of the barrel, if you will, the wine lees comes from the bottom part of the barrel. It's glutinous rice wines. They're all glutinous rice wines. And they're a little bit rough if you, you know, if you happen to be a French wine enthusiast, so to speak. But they do more cooking with them than drinking them. I'm sure that the seafaring men would strongly disagree, because I'm sure when they ship out, they bring along some to consume. But I don't know any Fujianese people who are heavy drinkers. That doesn't mean they don't exist. That means that I don't know them. Yes, sir?
You mentioned that in the fish ball, you have a smaller fish ball with meat or minced pork. Where does that come from? This is the first time I'm hearing that kind of blend.
All of the foods in this province have that blend. I think the fish ball is the most obvious because you see it. As soon as you bite in, you got this white thing, you bite in, it's brown in the middle. I think that the question of where it comes from is a tougher one to answer. I'm not sure I can tell you, because I'm not sure that I really know. I do know that since the 14, 1500s, I've seen records of use of these fish balls with meat inside. They probably, my guess, and this, believe me, is a guess, they probably, since they don't have or don't use a lot of grazing land, and they do graze a lot of animals in the low mountainous regions, they probably use much more fish than they use meat, and this is a way to combine them using a little bit of meat and a lot of fish. It's about, in the ratio, it's about 3-1. It's about, you have to have chopped up three times as much fish as of meat to make these meatballs. Yes, keep going, sir.
I'm sure you tasted it. What does it feel like?
What does it feel like? If it's made in a casserole, so it's cooked for a long time, it's going to be very soft. If it's made in a soup, like the one that's pictured on the page there, the fish has more of a texture. It's not as soft, but the meat is very, very soft on the inside, depending on how long they've cooked these fish balls in the soup. It's not only texture, because you have two textures, the texture of the fish and the texture of the meat, but it's also taste. You have two tastes together in the mouth. And most of the dishes have multiple ingredients. That Buddha, you know, jumping over the wall, can have as many as 40 different meats and fishes and seafoods in it, in one pot, if you will. They love many, many things together. Yes?
You mentioned that they cook with tea leaves or with the green tea itself?
Yes, they do cook with green leaves, well, if they're fresh, from the tea gardens, or with dried leaves, like you brew for tea, if you will. They use them in soups, in stews. They and the rest of China also use them to smoke foods. They do some smoking, not a lot, but some smoking of foods in the Fujian province. And they also use them minced, like an herb. So it would not be incorrect. I don't know if there's such a thing as right and wrong. I probably shouldn't use the term. But it wouldn't be incorrect to mince a few tea leaves into the meat that goes inside the fish ball, if you will. Yes, sir.
I have a couple of comments and maybe a couple of questions. You said about in English there's not much recipe books written about. I was thinking in India, I have not seen any cookbooks. Most of the Indians that came here started writing books because they imitated the Western culture. Because in the West, you write everything. You don't write everything. You just pass it on from generation to generation.
I'd like to invite you to my home, sir. I don't collect Indian cookbooks, but I probably have 30, 40 in English on different regions and some of the entire country of Indian cookbooks. Okay. We certainly have a lot of immigrants who've written them as well.
I applaud your research and effort. It's not to put you down in your research, but to kind of, I'm talking about history and tradition. And you know, when we are brought up, you know, I said, yeah, you can't cook it from a book. You know, you have to learn it from your mother or somebody watch or something like that. I don't know how far that is true, but you know, I'm always skeptical being an Indian. If I can cook something from the, I cook Indian food. I have no book.
Do you have children?
No.
Well, when you do, I want to come back and talk with you on whether or not they cook Indian food. Because I would say that about 25% of the readers of this magazine are Chinese who are buying it for their children because their children do not know the food culture. It's only from that type of reporting to you that I can tell you that there is some concern in that culture, and I can tell you in many others. You know, my family heritage was both German and Polish, and I can't cook a German or a Polish dish, you know, for love nor money. I think that many of the young people of all ethnic groups don't know their food culture to the degree that their parents and grandparents do, and the cookbooks serve a very important role in teaching them. And if I take one person who wrote some lovely words on the back of my cookbook, Grace Young, she was a food editor who edited, I don't really know the real number, but somewhere between 20 and 40 cookbooks, non-Chinese, for a major corporation for years. And one day she said, I don't even know my own culture. She's married to a German gentleman, and she didn't know anything about Chinese food, and she suddenly realized, hey, my parents and my grandparents and my aunties and uncles are all going to die, and I'm not going to know anything. Furthermore, I live in New York, and they live in California, and I better do something about that. So she started to go out west more frequently to see what she could learn for herself. And after some 6 months or a year of this, she said, by golly, none of my Chinese friends know this any better than I do. And that was how she wrote her first Chinese cookbook, and she's since written more than one. So I think the cultures of all countries, and I'm a gambling lady, I'm willing to bet with you that yours too has young people who haven't got a cockabolly clue about their food culture.
Well, they were born in the United States, but they're born in India.
But my book and other books like mine are not written for people in China. They can't read the thing any more than I can read theirs. I think that you have to understand that there's a very important role for you. And people who adore food, as you probably do, to advance your food culture for the people who are not living in India. You had a question, sir.
One last one before I forget it, I remember. You mentioned that one of the ingredients they use is coriander, and then at a brief glance of flavor and fortune, I also saw a connection of bitter melon to Kerala from India. Where did it, did the Chinese grow it originally? Indigenously, or did it come from somewhere else and they started playing with it?
That's a great question. Many of the foods in Southeast Asia have traveled around from one country to another. In terms of bitter melon, the Kerala, which you're speaking about, there are a couple of varieties that did, or they, the historians believe, did have origins in China. There are also some of the more bitter ones, the more bumpy and thinner ones that certainly have origins in India. I think that food historians are finally getting on the stick, and they're finally really trying to figure out a lot of this information. And almost every country now has a food history group of people, or even an institute, where people are beginning to narrow this information down and have good answers. And some of the answers, you know, get changed over time because they found out that they were incorrect. Coriander, also known as cilantro, excuse me, or Chinese parsley, did have origins in southern China. Can you give me a glass of water, please, sir? Sorry. Thank you. But that doesn't mean that it didn't also, at the same time, or close to the same time, also start in another country. Just think about seeds. How do seeds, you know, move around the world? How do they move around your garden, or my garden? The wind does a fine job, or the water, you know, washes them down, or whatever. So that, that and birds. Birds do a fantastic job of, you know, eating some here and, you know, and getting rid of them as waste there. So that it's very difficult to pinpoint that stuff down, but we're beginning to do a better job. Yes, sir.
What I've noticed is I mean, I like food, my family's from there, not very much, but in China, like, the food, the regional food that is very popular is, like, Sichuan or Guangdong, or maybe, you know, a couple, you know, some places like Shanghai or Beijing, but you rarely see a Fuzhou restaurant outside of Fuzhou. Like, you would never see a Fuzhou restaurant in Beijing or in Guangzhou, whereas you'd see a Sichuan restaurant in Beijing.
That was true. Well, I don't know when the last time he was there. I was in Shanghai and Hangzhou and Shaoxing in December. And one of my goals was, because I'm nuts, in the back of my head somewhere says maybe you should also write a Dongbei cookbook, you know, because only one in China and we sure don't have any here. In any case, so I asked the graduate students who were the professor who had invited me to this meeting, thought that I would get lost in Shanghai or something. It was my 10th trip to China. I felt pretty confident, but he didn't. So he sent these two graduate students to shepherd me around. And they were instructed, because I had written to him, to take me to Dongbei restaurants, because that's what I wanted to see most. The book was already in press, you know, this particular one. And I was amazed that within a 5-block area of where the hotel I was staying in, there were 3 or 4 Dongbei restaurants. There were many Fuzhou restaurants. I saw a Fuzhou restaurant in Hangzhou. I saw one Fujianese restaurant in Shaoxing. I must confess I didn't go in because I was gonna, but I asked about a particular dish which I was trying to learn more about, and they didn't have it there. So I did not go in. Probably should have, then I could answer your question better, certainly. But I think that that's changing because Chinese people are much more free to travel and open businesses than they have been in the past. And, you know, if I'm have a small restaurant over here, you know, and I want to go over there, hey, I could make a few bucks that way too. So I think you're seeing that change. And if you look at Fujianese restaurants in this country, we have not had, until maybe 5-10 years ago, any that were clearly Fujianese. But Fujianese people have lived in this country for somewhere between 50 and 100 years. They just either didn't have the money or the inclination, or they knew that we weren't going to go patronize their places. So they didn't open them. That's a very generic answer, but I really don't know any other way to respond to that. Any other questions? Yes, ma'am.
You mentioned that a lot of it includes soups. So a large part, is it because, like you said, it's a poor place, so if there's very little meat and, you know, this thing, by using filler food like noodles, etc., it would make the dish bigger? Is that the purpose of making it into a soup?
I don't think so. I think they like liquid type of foods. Because even their casseroles, what we would call casseroles in this country, are more wet than dry, so to speak. So I don't really think so. I think it's a great question. I'm answering what I think, not what I know. And please keep it in that frame. Any other? Yes.
May I ask about that?
Sure.
Most of the people I talk to, they say, the food we eat at Chinese here, it's not really Chinese. The Chinese food we eat in China is different from here. And the Chinese food, they also have some kind of sodium, something which is not good for your health and all these things.
I'm going to answer that backwards, if you will, but the last part first. You were referring to something called monosodium glutamate, MSG. If you are southern Chinese and from Guangdong province, the odds are very good you're going to use it in your cooking. If you're from the rest of China, you will certainly use a lot less of it. If I put two Chinese chefs up here, just randomly selected from restaurants, don't know what their philosophic base is, but they're not Cantonese. And I could ask one of them, hey, do you use some MSG? And he would say to me, yeah, sure. It's made from wheat, or we can extract it from sea plants, and it makes the food taste better. Here's the other guy, assuming they're both male, and he'd say, what, are you crazy? If people don't like my cooking the way it is, they don't need to add other stuff to make it taste better. No, I don't use it. So that's, first of all, a philosophic difference. The other piece of the difference is that traditionally, MSG was brought into China in the 1800s from Japan, where it was invented. And people, don't see anything wrong with it until somebody in this country did some research on infants and found out that, hey, it's not so good in large quantities that we feed adults that amount, so we better take it out of baby food. But let me tell you about MSG and put it to rest, or hopefully put it to rest here and now. The question is this: do you like tomatoes, people? Do you like mushrooms? If the answer to either or both of those questions is yes, you are eating so much glutamic acid, so many glutamates already, it's nonsense to pick on MSG. It was really, and many people believe this, an attack on the Chinese ethnicity and their restaurants, as opposed to attack on MSG. There are very, very few, and I've spoken to many researchers in this area, people who are allergic to MSG, get headaches or red in the face or whatever you want to call it from MSG, and mostly it's had, more than anything else, a bad rap. It will not get rid of that bad rap for generations, for sure. But I taught at Queen's College and I taught food sciences class, and I would have students on the very first day fill out a form, you know, are you allergic to any foods, anything you don't eat for religious reasons, personal reasons, social reasons, whatever. Put it down here. And then I would take those things home and I would look at them, and many of them, I started teaching in the 70s, many of them had MSG on their list. And then the next class, I would notice that same kid, eating tomatoes or in their sandwich or mushrooms or something. And I would go up to them, because I would remember the name, and I'd say, hey, you told me that you are allergic to MSG and other glutamates. Is that true? Oh, yes, Dr. Newman. I said, well, would you mind taking the tomato out of that sandwich, honey lamb? Because there's a devil of a lot of glutamates in that sandwich. So we have a lot of things here that have nothing to do with here or here. And I think that I would put that one at the top of my, very top of my list.
So you would follow the food in China cooked differently than in the restaurants?
I'm not sure what the question is. Start this one again and ask the question specifically and I'll be glad to answer, okay?
What I was told is what we are eating in America, the Chinese food in the restaurants, is not really Chinese.
Depends on who's cooking it and who's eating it. If you go to a Chinese restaurant where the bulk of the customers are Chinese, the odds are 10 to 1 that it's very much like Chinese food. But look, the things that grow here in the United States may not be what grows in the town or province where that chef comes from. So he's going to make it a little bit more Western with Western ingredients. And furthermore, every restaurateur is not a charity organization. They're in business to make a buck. That's why they went into the restaurant business, to support themselves and their families, and some of them their extended families. They're not going to sell you what you don't like. So if they're in a region where there are very few Chinese people, you better believe that the most important dish on the menu is beef with broccoli. That is the most popularly consumed dish in the United States. Does that dish exist in China? You bet your sweet bippy it does. However, they don't use American broccoli, they use gailan, and they don't cook it the way we do. They cook it to a Chinese taste, and that very same dish in the Fujian province will taste different than in the Sichuan province, than in Guangzhou, than in Beijing, than in Harbin. So that the question that you're asking plagues many people. You're in good company, if you will. However, it's a nonsense question because it's not specific enough to get a decent answer from me or from anyone else. No restaurateur is cooking what won't sell. He'd be out of business tomorrow. I mean, it's that simple. So is the food very Chinese in a Chinese restaurant? Is the food very Indian in an Indian restaurant? Look, if you're from Kerala or you're from Calcutta, you're going to get two different kinds of tastes. So be it in Chinese restaurants. It's just so easy to attack a cuisine that we know nothing about and a culture we know nothing about in a different environment than where that cuisine and the culture began. And I personally think it's not a good thing to do. I would look for the kind of Chinese food that you like, and I would see that I got what I like if I was in your shoes. And, you know, I know precisely what, you know, the kinds of foods that I like to eat. And you might not like to sit at my table. But then again, I might not like to sit at yours. Because there is a plethora. I started out this talk, you know, an hour ago, and told you that there's more than 10,000 known dishes in China. So what are you tasting? Which one? I don't know. And I don't know which one you're evaluating. And sometimes I don't even know which one I'm evaluating. Take one more question if there be one. Hearing none, again, thanks very much for coming.